Hi, welcome to Music and Mind. My name's Deanne Hunt. I'll be here weekly to introduce you to some of our area's most talented and insightful musicians and luminaries. Join us here each week on Channel 23 or on YouTube at Music and Mind anytime to gain an inside view of our local luminaries. Hope to see you soon. Hi, I'm Dan Hunt. Welcome to Music in Mind. Weekly we discuss, as we said in our intro, either musicians or we have local luminaries who are psychologists or things of that nature on. Today we have Dr. George Anderheggen, and he's a clinical psychologist from Monroe that he practices. He used to practice in Newtown. George, I've had the pleasure of knowing you for at least 15 years now, and you've been a big inspiration to me. You've helped me through a lot of my issues and inspired me to keep going. Can you tell me a little about yourself from your history?
Yeah, how I got where I am today starts when I was born on February 14th, 1928, which gives me about 86 years of hanging around. My family was dysfunctional, but loving. Parents, we were divorced when I was in fifth grade, and I'm the oldest of four children. So that gives you a little bit of background there. In 1941, because things were so confused, I went in the Merchant Marine at the age of 15, as I said. That was quite an experience. I went to England and then through the Panama and then to the Philippines, and then I came home and muddled through a lot of odd jobs until 1952, when I married the first time. And I got drafted as soon as I got married because they decided I was a draft dodger because I was in the Merchant Marine. Today, it's all changed. They now honor the Merchant Marine, but back then that was not the case.
Yeah.
And let's see. Well, after getting married, I became a salesman. Well, I went to college at UConn, became sales manager for a little plastics outfit, and then became a department manager for Cheeseboro Ponds. Let's see, after that, I became a clergyman, an Episcopal clergyman. And then in 72, I started in this field. I had tried everything and nothing fit. And I spent a lot of years trying to find things that fit, tried many different therapeutic approaches, and here I am today. Five kids, my second wife, hers, mine, and ours. All great. That's a quick run through.
Great. How did you get involved in this field? What was it that compelled you to get?
That's a good question. Excellent. I was, as I said, an Episcopal clergyman, and I was seeing a lot of people and talking to them, and they're talking to me and sharing stuff. And I really didn't like the pomp and circumstance, and I had gotten into a lot of hot water with the police in Bridgeport way back when, because I was pretty outspoken, and the John Birch Society.
You too, huh?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you know what happens to outspoken people.
Yes, I do.
And that led me to a testing psychologist in Stanford who I went to see, and he gave me a bunch of tests and said, well, you should become a psychiatrist. Well, I had no interest in that. I'm not an intellectual. I'm just a guy. And so I just started working on becoming a psychotherapist and did that and got a PhD in that field through Columbia University in California, not the Columbia in New York.
So you went all the way out there to study?
No, I did it through...
Oh, correspondence.
Telecommunications, yeah.
So you've been in the field how long, you say?
About 40 years.
Wow.
A little over, maybe.
No wonder. You're such... Well, you have, from my experience, you have so much therapeutic ways that you, things that you've studied. I mean, I don't think there's a thing that you haven't studied.
I'm sure there are a few things that I haven't, but I probably shouldn't.
Well, hypnotism in particular, I know that you're quite accomplished in. And you're able to specifically help people with PTSD, which is a very difficult thing to deal with through that methodology.
Well, hypnosis, that's interesting you mention that, because I believe in my heart of hearts that we're all hypnotized. We're all machines.
As you know, I concur.
And why wouldn't we be? We were born and...
Culture.
I think of it as having stuff funneled in. We have a funnel on top of our head, and it just gets funneled in until, you know, the terrible twos, and they're not really terrible because it's a beginning of maybe standing up a little. And then, you know, you get five, six, seven. But by then, there's a lot of stuff in there.
Very few drops of truth, per se.
Yes, you got my art thing with the little
did.
Drop of truth.
Yes, I did. It was very good. I wish I, unfortunately, I forgot to bring it with me today, but I wish we had it to show.
Well, it's the hardest thing that we have to face, in my opinion, is the fact that we all, whether we want to admit it or not, are programmed. And it only stops when we start to look at ourselves and
reflect.
See who we are, what we are, what we do from a very deep inside.
Right, beyond our delusionary masks.
Yeah, the illusions that we have about ourselves.
Right. And,
yep, that's true.
The work, so to speak, as I believe George Gurdjieff speaks of it.
Yes.
Is getting free of that, what he calls, I believe, a formatory apparatus.
That's Gurdjieff and Ouspensky and, Nicole.
Right.
Maurice Nicole, the five volumes of his work.
Yeah, I understand you just completed reading that stuff.
Well, not five of them, but
the first
two or three.
My Enneagram work deals with that too, understanding the
difference. Well, the second volume has, I think, the first seven chapters deal with the Enneagram.
Uh-huh.
So, very interesting.
Yes.
I still don't understand it.
Uh-huh. I found that to be a very interesting part of understanding myself and others, was to go through those little seed fears that we have, and seed shames and identities, I think.
Well, when I first met you 15 years ago, you were talking and working with that Enneagram, and it was fascinating.
Yeah, I found it completely self-revealing.
It makes us look at ourselves at a more in-depth level.
In addition, it helped me to have compassion for other people, because then I could understand them as well.
Absolutely.
I could understand myself.
But you have to understand yourself. It's like, I think there was some prayer somewhere that says that first you... love God, then love your neighbor, and love yourself. But if you can't love yourself, how can you love your neighbor, and how can you love God?
Bingo.
Yeah, and that's...
It's an inside job.
It is. If we don't look at ourselves, and we don't want to see it, because there's a lot of ugliness in all of us.
Exactly.
And I don't want to be that way. I want to be... I want to be thought of as a wonderful person. Well, I'm not a wonderful person. I have
Some of you is.
Some of me. Well, now we're talking about Ouspensky and the many eyes. You know what I mean?
Well, I don't know if our audience does. But I don't know if our audience does, but I have an idea.
Well, the many eyes is that I'm not just one eye. You know, I'm not I. I'm this eye, and then at another minute, I'm another eye, and at another minute.
Exactly.
And, you know, at one
labels.
Moment, I think this is who I am, and then 20 minutes later, I contradict myself, so I'm a bunch of these things.
Pieces of 8,000, maybe.
Yeah, or 8 million.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
All those many identities that we carry as labels upon us.
Yes.
Did you see the cartoon of the, if everybody was labeled in Congress about their donations, how they look like NASCAR drivers? They have all these different emblems on them.
Yeah.
Well, that's essentially what you're talking about here, right?
Yeah, we identify with this or that. And once we're right. identified with it.
I also notice that there's, I also find these holes in myself. Like, can you identify with that? Like, I feel empty in certain spots. Like, I'm not good enough at this, or I'm not good enough at that.
Well,
shame.
I hear what you're saying. You know, we get that feeling, but where does the feeling come from? Well, sometimes it comes from a thought, sometimes it comes from another feeling, or sometimes it comes because there's a couple of voices in all of our heads that say this,
yes.
that, and then pretty soon we focus on the negative and feel rotten about ourselves,
yes.
and then it gets going.
Mm-hmm. The negative feedback from authoritarian
yeah.
people in our lives? Often.
Well, yeah, but it's at this point in my life when I there's a Buddhist, a female Buddhist.
Yes.
What's her? Oh, Pema Chodron.
Right.
Very bright, wonderful lady. And she says, you know, in meditation, just meditate on your breath.
Mm-hmm.
And then a thought comes up and just say, it's just a thought. That's all it is. Because we're ruled by these negative thoughts. Positive
and,
thoughts are fine.
And feelings.
Oh, yeah.
In particular.
Well, you get a feeling and you don't know where it comes from.
Right.
Then you take the thought and you start
mm-hmm.
mixing them like in a wearing blender.
Exactly.
And it's yeah. painful stuff.
Yeah, I like to say it's like the way a pearl is developed around a shell and an oyster, or
yeah.
around a pearl and an oyster. But mm-hmm. unfortunately, it doesn't turn out to be a pearl. It turns out to be
a
black pearl, right?
A what?
A black pearl.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, this show is about music and mind. And I wondered, do you do any work with music as a method of healing?
I wanted to show you this book. I'm sure you probably have.
Well, for our audience, maybe camera one can take a shot of this. It's called This Is Your Brain on Music by subtitled A Science of Human Obsession by Daniel J. Levitin.
And it's fascinating. I haven't picked up a musical instrument in many years. And a few months ago, I picked up the guitar again and started working with it. And, you know, I've had a client who brought me in some CDs that he wanted me to listen to. He's maybe 20 years old. And I listened to these CDs, and I never felt so depressed in my life. And the next time I saw him, I said, what is that? He says, that's called dark music.
So you knew
really
it.
Dark music. And here's a young man who used to come home after school, go to his room, and listen to dark music. So, yeah, music.
It's the opposite of a hymn type of music.
Yes, it is. And then, you know, people will compare and say, well, that's not the right kind of hymn. That's not really God's hymn. And, you know, it's like people get competitive.
Good and
about
bad and splitting. And yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
Instead of, I believe that polarities are supposed to be complementary instead of oppositional.
Yeah, well.
Or in a balance, or used in the right way.
Yeah, trying to get some kind of a balance. I'm working on a book right now that's called Seesaw, Marriage Flaw. And it's the idea that, you know, we're on this teeter-totter.
Yeah.
You remember the old Seesaw, yes. Marjorie Daw?
Yeah.
And how do we keep some kind of balance? This, you know, this side.
Yin and yang. Side.
Yeah. And how do we bring that into our life, mm-hmm. into our inner life?
Integrate
or at least
it.
Look at our inner life. Is it like this?
Right.
And if it is, how do we work on it?
Exactly. And that's, again, that's a good way to get into our next topic of how do we go about healing these things? What would you recommend? Especially for traumas.
Well,
with music, is there any musical methods that you would recommend? Well,
I think there's some very interesting bits of, how would you call it, music? Meditative type of music, where you can listen. Some of the oriental things.
Sitar work,
yeah.
Maybe?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It depends upon yourself as a person. It, you know, you said something about how do we heal? What do we use? What methods? My own personal take on that is it depends upon the person. We don't want to take a person and put them in the equestrian bed, you know, make them fit our therapeutic method. That's why I guess I studied so many different ones, because
everybody's got their own key? Kind of?
Well, maybe their own approach to the lock. The key may be our relationship with our higher power.
Right.
It's like, well, you and I know something about
12-step
groups, 12 steps, and one of the things that I'm interested in is that in my experience, we never spent a lot of time talking about not the first step, but the second and third. It's like,
yeah.
You know, my idea of God has to change.
Exactly. I had to change mine.
If it doesn't change, I'm in real trouble. God is not a
friendly being.
Well, God is not a Santa Claus.
That either, right.
And not that Santa Claus is bad, but Santa Claus is only a concept of
right.
love for children.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, you know, we have to have a much broader.
Yes.
And be much more able to connect.
Yes.
I mean, they say the kingdom of God is within.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I had the opposite problem with the negative father image, where I had the condemning, critical type. So when I said the Our Father when I went to Catholic school, I always thought of my father. So that's the kind of internal father that I developed.
Yes, that was.
I'm certainly reframing that now that, you know, he's left this realm, and certainly understand him a lot better than I ever have before. And I really appreciate his principled nature much more than I ever did. He stood for virtue adamantly.
Yeah.
And that was certainly his sort of virtue.
It's difficult. My you know, I mentioned my father and my mother at the beginning, and my father was, you know, at the age of 8, he wanted to send me to Nazi Germany to be in the German Bund, and that was a close call. And I, you know, I wouldn't be here today. I'd probably be dead. But and so I had this father who was kind of a Nazi Gestapo type.
Okay.
And then my mother was an Italian, and she, you know, came under the guise of Mussolini. So between the two parents,
wow.
But they were very loving. And that may have been what saved
me. Saving grace, like my mother was.
Yeah.
My mother's 100th birthday was yesterday, would have been yesterday.
Wow.
She passed away in 2011.
Okay.
But she was a beaut. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't have made it.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, she made the balance in my life and gave me the heart. The best parts of me I owe to her.
Yeah, it they at least gave us that.
Right, those few drops.
Little tiny piece of heart.
Exactly.
That we could look at and not have to. We don't have to stay completely hypnotized. We don't have to stay
in the negativity.
And we don't have to stay
right.
completely machine.
So that's a good, you know, like as we've often discussed personally before. I believe it's a form of de-hypnosis, as you alluded to.
Yeah, but I have to do it
exactly
on myself.
It's an inside job.
Yeah,
right?
It really is, because fear and resistance keep us away from de-hypnotizing.
Exactly.
So I have to want to do it.
That's right. The courage to change the things I can, so to speak.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
That's the real maturity.
Yeah.
Acceptance is easy. It's courage that's the hard
yeah.
part.
And the first thing in the AA and mm-hmm. Emotions Anonymous and that is we are helpless
mm-hmm. Step
without
one.
Some. I mean, the world is crazy.
Accept truth.
Yeah.
Accept no matter how difficult this is. I have this saying that I sometimes use. It's better to be disillusioned than to remain illusioned for the rest of my life.
That's, you know. You got it right on the nose.
And you and I are both up that same alley when it comes to that.
But, you know, the percentage of people that are going to be doing it this time around are probably very few. And maybe we do come around. Who knows?
I understand you had some very good influences in your life, including studying with the actual Milton Erickson.
Yeah, I studied with Milton. I have been very fortunate to have had that opportunity. Not as much as I might have liked to have been.
The father of modern hypnosis.
Yep, and then, well, I had the chance to with Alexander Lowen and Virginia Satir and...
With trauma? Trauma?
Not with trauma.
Somatic therapy?
Yeah, no. That's been more reading and on my own and really facing the people that are in that spot. And it's a very delicate spot. It's not... I know there are therapies where they want to get in there and do it right away.
Mm. Much more permissive approach you use?
Yeah, but not a talking approach. In other words, if you watch a person, you can see their pain. You can feel their pain, or at least...
Compassion.
I can pick up that, and then I can help them to walk into that.
Right, I can identify first.
Yeah. And then, you know, they can start to share it a little bit.
Right. That's what happened with me in 12-step, is that I saw other people sharing their stories, and I, all of a sudden I felt safe enough to share mine.
Yeah. And I will share my stories.
Right.
And sometimes it's not a good idea, but they backfire on you, but I still...
I
don't worry about it.
I mean, you know, when I've seen you personally, it's almost been like you've told me my story before I even had to tell you mine.
Well,
you know,
yeah.
And it's like, oh my God, somebody else that understands me, knows me.
Yeah, we're not alone.
Right.
We have these crazy thoughts that go through our mind at 90 miles an hour.
Right.
And then we sit there and say, how could I think that? That's terrible. And that comes out of my religious background, you know. I remember the nun saying to me, even the thought is the deed.
Oh, yes.
Well,
I remember that.
That was, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And
institutional hypnosis.
Yeah.
Whatever it is, whether it's religion or
and, you know,
education.
I look at it, I don't want to put any of the religions down because I think they're all doing their very best because they're hypnotized.
From their side of the mountain.
Right? Yeah, and it's still the mountain.
Right. At the peak, you can see all the different angles, but it takes a while to get there.
Yeah, and oftentimes we slide down.
Yeah, and oftentimes I think I'm at the peak when really I'm only at the summit, at the base of the...
You know? You're right, absolutely.
The more I know, the more I realize I don't know.
Is, you know, in that the work, or the fourth way by Grigiev and Ouspensky, they talk about vanity. And boy, how much vanity... I can have, and how much the ego gets in the way.
Okay, I don't know how much time we have left. I think we have a minute.
Okay.
So, can you give me a summary, quick?
A what?
A summary of maybe the work that's working for you.
The work that's working for me these days is... I'm working on myself more than I ever have. I'm finding the people who are talking about looking at yourself and trying to work on looking at myself, who I am on the inside.
Right.
And not being critical of it. In other words, being a self-observer. Trying not to take inventory.
Right, not to judge.
Not to judge, you know, take the beam out of my eye and forget the little splinter in yours.
Absolutely. Buddha said that there's really only one of us, I believe.
Yeah.
And universe means one song.
Yeah.
You know, there's been songs written to that nature, etc.
Yep.
So I want to, I concur with your methodologies, I am just so happy to have you as a guest because you've been so influential in my life and you've done so much to help so many people.
Well, thank you. And we all need help.
Right.
And those who choose to do the work, and there are many who don't.
My guest, Dr. George Anderheggen. Thank you so much for joining us, George. And if you just sit a spell and we'll talk.
Yes, wonderful.
It's been a pleasure having you. Thanks for watching us. I hope you'll join in with us again next week. And I think we'll probably have a musical guest. We have a couple of musical guests set up. So get to enjoy some of the musical end of our show. So thanks all for watching. And I hope to see you soon. Hi, welcome to Music in Mind. My name's Deanne Hunt. I'll be here weekly to introduce you to some of our area's most talented and insightful musicians and luminaries. Join us here each week on Channel 23 or on YouTube at Music in Mind anytime to gain an inside view of our local luminaries. Hope to see you soon.